is at their fathers too. I know many of us mentor people and work with young people, and that's what it's about, is spreading the gospel of Christ. So I want to say happy Father's Day. I want to also, you know, this is being broadcast live online for those who aren't comfortable coming to church yet. And so we want, you know, we still want to reach out to them and minister to those individuals as well. So I want to welcome all those that are logging in online as we are getting started this morning. I have a few announcements. The van total is up to $13,298.16. So we're getting every week we're getting closer to our actual goal. For those of you that have made pledges, just, you know, if you would stay true to those pledges, that will help us get there faster as well. The other thing we have going on, as of this morning, we've been able to reach over 85,000 people with the message of salvation for Jesus Christ. I mean, through this ministry. And you give Jesus a hand and clap. This is about, because to me, it's about us growing as individuals, but it's also about growing the kingdom of God. And so we've had over 300 inquiries to people who want to accept Jesus Christ for the first time. So, you know, keep us in prayer as we, you know, continue to minister. A lot is happening through the Authenticity Show that airs on Monday nights on the Now Network. This Monday at 6, we have the longest reigning chaplain in the NFL, Sean Mitchell. He will be our special guest this week. And he's also the pastor of New Venture Church in San Diego. Of course, the team has moved from San Diego to Los Angeles, so he's no longer the chaplain. But he has some great, great stories and great things about how the Lord moved in his life. He shares a story about Drew Brees and also Junior Seau. And all you sports people probably know who those are. And some of the ladies are like, okay. But he has a great testimony, and I think everyone would enjoy it. But that's tonight at 6, and we're it's being seen in over 156 million homes around the globe. So that's happening right here from Steubenville. You know, our church, our ministry, reaching the world with the love and the gospel of Jesus Christ. So for all those that are watching online as well, we'd love to fellowship with you and, you know, have you come to 220 North 4th Street here in Steubenville. I don't care where you are in the world. If you're ever this way, come by and see us. And, you know, we have some great things that God is doing in our midst here. The other thing I wanted to share with you is Bible study is, we're doing it virtually right now. It seems to work because we've been able to have individuals like Cheyenne be on, you know, some of the individuals with kids that, you know, we don't provide child care on Wednesday for the Bible study. They've been able to attend. We had a very powerful Bible study last Thursday. That Bible study's at 6:30, right? 6:30 on Thursdays. I know some of you may work and those kind of things, but we do try to record it and show that, and I do share the scriptures that we go over. But, you know, I'm hoping that this morning isn't the only time we crack open our Bible and get into the Word and into the presence of God. And there'll be some more things coming along those lines as well. I just want to encourage you, God's on the move here in Steubenville and here at First Christian Church. So today, we're going to go ahead and get started with worship. But before we do that, let's take a moment. I would like to, if anyone has any prayer requests, as we start off the service with prayer, I'd like to also take any prayer requests that anyone has this morning. Yes, I see Edna. Your sister? What's her first name? Crystal? Okay. So we're going to pray for Crystal. Okay. Yeah.
My mother, she rehabs. She has a listening.
Okay. Pray for your mother's recovery and rehab. Okay. And I don't know if you guys, you remember Davian and his brother Kyle that were coming. Well, I got a call this week. Kyle was rushed to the hospital, and he was induced and put in a coma because he has type 1 diabetes, and so he's out of the coma. He's as far as I know, he's still at the hospital. Of course, they won't let even ministers in there now. It's very tight at Trinity. Only his mom is allowed in the room. But I have talked with Davian, and I have a call in to the mother. But I mean, he's awake. He's doing, he's on the mend. But keep him and Davian in your prayers. Davian is, they have I don't know, their brother's like 4 or 5 years old, and he has some health things, and Davian's been watching him while his mom's been at the hospital with his brother. So keep those boys in our prayers and as well. So anyone else? Jackson, yeah, let's pray for Jackson, and his little guy had his tonsils taken out, so, So anyone else?
Lori?
Yeah.
I'm starting a new job tomorrow.
All right.
As a Christian school administrator, so just pray for me.
All right, congratulations. Yes. New ventures, new things, new challenges, but new opportunities as well. So we'll keep you in our prayers, especially tomorrow as you step into that new position. But we'll pray this morning. Anyone else?
Mike,
yes. Okay. All right. Well, praise God.
Marie had to go back to the hospital. She had an infection along her incision line.
Okay. We'll keep Marie in our prayers as well. Anyone else? Just if you do, say it. If not, we're going to pray. And if something comes up later on, we'll have another opportunity. Well, Father God, I pray this morning that you would have that you would be glorified and honored in what we do here as we worship you and as we magnify your name. Lord, you've heard these prayer requests. We heard the report of the doctor of Crystal with breast cancer. We hear the report of Kyle with diabetes. We heard a report of Mike's granddaughter that had ear surgery, and Jackson that had to have his tonsils taken out, and Lord, even Kevin's mother, Lord God, who has fallen, Lord. I just pray, Lord, that you are the great physician and you're the great healer, Lord, and that all those that have suffered ailments and things, Lord God, we trust your report. We lean upon you, Lord God. We look to you for which there's healing in your wings, Lord God. So we thank you, Lord God, and speak that healing over each and every one of those situations. Father God, I thank you, Lord God, for the grace that you're giving to Lori right now as she walks into a new position, as she walks into a new chapter in her life, Lord God, that you would anoint her and grace her, Lord God, to do all that you've called her to do, Lord God, and that she would bring that Christian education to another level, Father, as she's obedient to you. I pray, Lord God, for a smooth transition, Lord, there for her and all that and all the plans and all the things that you have for her there, the vision that you have for that school as well. Lord, we give you glory and honor. We lock our faith with her faith this morning. Lord, I pray for all those, Lord God, out there right now that may be online or that are listening elsewhere, Lord God. I pray, Lord, for your peace. I pray that your anointing would touch them and that they would be blessed as well as we continue to worship you here this morning in song. And all of God's people said,
Amen.
Amen.
Well, good morning, everybody. I would just like you guys to join me as we, you know, celebrate and honor the fathers around the world. Let's give praise to the one who's seated on the throne in heaven. I've heard a thousand stories of what they think you're like, but I've heard a tender whisper of love in the dead of the night when you tell me that you're pleased and that I am never alone. You're a good, good father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. I've seen many searching for answers far and wide, but I know we're all searching for answers. Only you provide, 'cause you know just what we need before we say a word. You're a good, good father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. You're a good, good father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. You are perfect. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You're perfect in all of your ways to us. God, you are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You're perfect in all of your ways to us. There's love so undeniable, I can hardly speak in peace so unexplainable. I can hardly think as you call me, deeper still as you call me, deeper still as you call me, deeper still into love, love, love. You're a good, good father. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. You're a good, good father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder, who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you would lay down your life, that I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you would lay down your life, that I would be set free. Ooh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain.
Sing that with me again. Think about what you're really saying.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. And worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Yes, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you would lay down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done. You have never let me down when my strength is failing. You will lift me up. You're the one who makes me whole. face of trials, you perfect me, God. So I will glorify you, God. And I will glorify your name. Even when I'm lost in doubt, your plans are hope for me. Even when I've lost my faith, you still have faith in me. You have brought me out of darkness, so I can live my life. I will live for you. There's no other love like yours, for you've given everything you have for me, and no one knows me like you do. From the very start, you've known my every breath, so I will glorify you, God. And I will glorify your name. Even when I'm lost in doubt, your plans are hope for me. Even when I've lost my faith, you still have faith in me. You have brought me out of darkness, so I can live my life. And I will live for you. Even when I'm lost in doubt, your plans are hope for me. Even when I've lost my faith, you still have faith in me. You have brought me out of darkness, so I can live my life. I will live for you. I will live for you. I choose today to live for you. I will live for you now and forever. Cause you have never let me down. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You have never let me down. Oh, you have never let me down.
We are thankful for God's faithfulness to us. Amen. 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 What an awesome God we serve. Today's message, the title is 7-Eleven. Okay. And, I got to spend a lot of time, I feel fortunate in so many ways and been blessed in so many places in my life, and one of the things that I really always look forward to was, going to sporting events with my father, even from a young age. And I remember even going and playing basketball, and then with, or at least I would, they would play, and then I'd be the guy shooting at the other end of the court, and they'd be calling, clear the court, because they were coming back down, and, I was getting in the way of those things. But I never felt like I was in the way. It was time spending with Dad and around what he was doing and those things. And And that continued when I was in, you know, college. We, you know, there was a group of us that went to Larkins Hall, and any of the you that have been to the Ohio State University know where that is. And there's a on 7th or on Lane Avenue, which runs parallel to the university, near the campus there. There was a 7-Eleven, and you know, if I was really, you know, we'd work out, and after we were done, they sold the big gulp, you know, and right. You'd get one of those, you know, a 44-ounce, and you could get it refilled for, I think, like a dime or a quarter or something. So, you know, we'd get that, and if we were really blessed, we would go and get some Buffalo Wild Wings from BW3's right on High Street around the corner, and you know, those were memories. But I'm not actually talking this morning. My message is not on the store 7-Eleven. My message is based out of Matthew chapter 7, verse 11. So if you would, turn there with me, and we're going to, as we read the scriptures here together. When you're there, say amen. And I just, while we're turning there, I just want to welcome Cheyenne and Drew and Chris and all those that have logged online and that, you know, asking for prayer requests for different individuals. I want you to know we're praying for them, and you know, just I'm encouraged by what God's doing through that. So, if you're there, Matthew chapter 7, verse 11, it says this. It says, "If you then, being evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father, who is in heaven, give what is good to those who ask him?" And that said with an exclamation point. So he wasn't whispering this. He was saying, how much good will your Father give you if you ask him? And so let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, anoint these lips of clay one more time to your people, Lord God. Allow us not only to gain knowledge, but the understanding of your word, and more importantly, the wisdom of applying that knowledge in our everyday, in our practical lives. We give you glory and honor in the wonderful name of Jesus. Amen. So Jesus was telling them, you know, and I know when we started the service, we have many fathers in here, and some of us have, you know, we either have, you know, fathers that, you know, like I said, I was blessed. My father, he worked. My father always was home. We always had food on the table. I never once, you know, we never had to worry about where we were going to stay. You know, I was blessed in those ways. And I know that's not everybody's experience, especially today. I know that there are some things that people have gone through. But I want you to know that we have a Father in heaven. So no matter who you are or where you're at this morning, we have a Father who's a good Father in heaven that provides us with all the things that we need and everything that we have. And it said that we have to ask of him. How much more, you know, and I remember during in life, you know, asking my dad for certain things. Now, there were certain things he just wasn't into, you know. He didn't want any pets in the house, you know. I found a dog, and he said, well, you know, he didn't directly say no, but he said, we're going out of town this weekend. What are we going to do with that dog? So I found somebody to take care of the dog, and so that night I tied the dog up to the swing set that was in our backyard. That was a bad move on my part. You know, my dad said, no, I told you you can't have no dog here. So there were things that, you know, I had a great father. I have a great father. But there were things that he didn't want. But the Bible says, how much more will our Heavenly Father give us if we ask him? And I think there are so many times that we go through things in life that we're not taking the time to recognize or even to hear God's voice. I think we allow our emotions to get the best of us at times. We allow things to, we have this knee-jerk reaction to things, and we allow the emotion of that to override that voice, that still small voice that's saying to us, I'm here. I'm knocking at the door of your heart. Let me in. I want to be a part of your situation. I've already provided a way out. I'm just waiting for you to come to me. I'm waiting for you to come to me and let me in, because I do have a plan for you. And this is backed up in the book of Psalms, chapter 68, verse 5 and 6, if you want to turn there. Psalm 68, verse 5 and 6, it says that a father of the fatherless and a judge for the widows is God in his holy habitation. He's a father to the fatherless. And even as an awesome of a father that I had, and even I had an awesome grandfather and my mother's father as well. There's things that I've learned, life lessons and things, but there were times where, you know, and of course my grandfather has gone on to be with the Lord, but there were times in my life where I needed that advice. I needed that thing, but they weren't there. But you know who was there? God was there. And Jesus said that I stick closer than a brother. And that if we call on him and we ask him, and God said, I become the father to the fatherless. And it goes on to say this. It says, God makes a home for the lonely. He leads out the prisoners into prosperity. Only the rebellious dwell in a parched land. You know how I know I'm blessed this morning? You know, I'm sitting down. We have a little, like, sitting room upstairs in our house. And, you know, Kate had already got her coffee. And I'm sitting there just, you know, meditating on what the Lord wants to do this morning. And she said, you want me to make you a cup of coffee? I said, yeah, if you could, bring me up a water. Well, she went down there, and there was no water in the coffee pot. There was no cold water in the fridge. And then the ice maker didn't have water in it, so it didn't make any ice. But you know what? Right around the corner, we have cases of water. See, God wants to pour out his love and his rain on the dry areas of our life. I know I'm blessed because even though the water wasn't where it needed to be at the moment, it was there. And there's a lot of times that because we get discouraged, or we allow that parched land to dictate to us. But the thing is that when we stay on track with God, that's when he sends the rain, the latter rain and the former rain, all in one season. And what rain represents is water represents what? Life. You know, we were in Israel, and they showed, you know, where Mount Hermon is, we were there during what would be their summer. And so it was hot out, but at the top of that mountain there was snow, and they said that it's that snow that melts, that comes down Mount Hermon, that feeds water right into Israel. And that's why that Gaza Strip there has been such a contentious place, because the enemy knows that if it can cut off the water supply to Israel, that they could control what happens there. Because without water, there's what? There's no vegetation. Without water, you can't keep the cows and the cattle and everything else healthy to be able to eat. But God, he said he'll send the rain. And not only the rain, but he said he's going to pour out what? His spirit upon all the earth. And all these things that are happening in the world today, and all the things that are happening in our individual lives, the thing that I want you to know this morning is we don't have to worry. Because we have a good Father. We have a God that will take care of us. And this morning I was thinking about the characteristics of a good Father. A good father is what? Faithful. He's faithful. It says that God is what? Faithful and just to forgive us of what? Our sins. So when you mess up, God is there saying, It's my goodness that leads you to repentance. This morning, even if we mess up, even in our frailty, even in our human existence, we're going to make mistakes. But when we bring those mistakes under the blood of Jesus, see, what God sees from heaven is not the judgment seat, but he sees the mercy seat. The mercy seat that's immersed in the blood of his son, Jesus Christ. Not only is a good father faithful, but a good father is what? Truthful. And what does God say? God says, the Bible tells us what? God is not a man that he should lie. His words establish truth. This is why we can apply the word to our life. We can live that word out. And there are times, and what the enemy tries to do is try to make you think that that word is not true and that word is not for you. But I'm telling you what, there comes a day for each and every one of us that where the enemy is exposed. And the only way the enemy is exposed is when we let our light shine in the darkness. It's that light. It says in Revelation that when they bring forth the devil, it said, this is the manner of man that has deceived the whole world. You know, we have to know where his power is. But we have to get in the word. We have to learn how to trust and know that God is faithful, that he's truthful. Also, we know that God, a good man and a good father is what? He's a provider. He said that, what does the word tell us? That God will provide or give us what? He'll give us what we ask him for. According to what? His will in Christ Jesus. So when we follow him, it says that I can do all things through who? Christ Jesus that gives me strength. He's a provider. He provides a way where there is no way. He always provides a way out. From the beginning of time, from the very first sin of the world, before the foundation was set, the Lamb of God was slain for us. So he shall provide what? All of my needs. According to what? His riches and glory. No amount of money has left this earth. He owns 1,000 cattle on 1,000 hillsides. There's not a need that you have this morning or a need that you'll have tomorrow that God does not have the resources to provide. And when I talk to individuals that have gotten a hold of the truth and knowing and trusting God with their finance, trusting God with their time, trusting God with getting in his word, during this whole shutdown, their businesses exploded. Their income increased. God took care of them during this time. And what is awesome about God, he did it in several different ways. He did it in several different ways. One business, they increased, and this is in our church, their business increased almost 50% over what it did last year during everything being shut down, during a time where most businesses shut their doors never to open again. There was one person in our church. God started dealing with them about debt. So they started getting rid of debt before all of this. And they started saving money. And so when this happened, and while one of the spouses' businesses had to shut down and that income wasn't there, they never missed a beat during this time. See, that's the God we have. He gives us plans. And so that plan, he's a provider. But that plan, God's plan for you is not to hurt you or to harm you, but to what? Keep you and bless you and prosper you. That's the good God we serve. That's what a good father does. But the thing is that we have to be, there's a prescribed way. And that way is the word of God. And we have to live according to that word, and we have to live according to the obedience that he sets for us. A lot of times we shake our hands and our fists to God and ask him why. And sometimes I hear, Why not? Why have you not followed what I said to do here? Repent. Because what I have for you, I'm still holding. I'm just waiting on you to receive it and to do the things that I've said. You know, a lot of times I think about Moses. And he's leading the children of Israel. Now he's going on a word from God. That's all he had was a word from God. And he sees God do all these things. And they're finally walking out of Egypt. And they're standing there and it's like, uh-oh. Pharaoh's army's pursuing us. And we got this body of water in front of us. And half of us can't swim. That was a joke. But they could. It was too far for them to swim. What do we do? And see, a lot of us would be like, "Well, God just said this," and we just start marching because we're saying, "Well, God said this," and we miss that still small voice of God's instruction. And what was God's instruction? It said, "Be still." So that means what? Take a moment. And know that I'm God, so that what? We can hear his instruction. And a lot of times we just have to take that moment before we take that action to be still. To have the peace of God to hear him say, "Moses, you see that staff you have in your hand? That's not just a walking stick to go through the wilderness. But I want you to take that and I want you to put it down in that water and I'm going to part the sea. And I'm going to have my people. I'm going to have my church. I'm going to have those who have dedicated themselves and committed themselves to the word of God to walk on dry land." And as they walked and they went through, Pharaoh's army saw the dry land and thought, "You know what? If they could do it, we can do it." But they miss one important thing, the obedience of God's word. And they pursued them because they had hatred in their heart. How can these slaves think that they can be free? And they can kill our children and bring plagues on us. How can they do that? We're going after them. And as they pursued them and went after them, that body of water closed up and took Pharaoh's army as God's people walked on dry land and walked into the promised land. See, God has you on a journey this morning. And some of us, that's why the Apostle Paul said, don't grow weary in well-doing, but to run the race in a manner in which, to win it. This isn't a sprint. It's not always going to be easy. The enemy's going to try to come, and he's going to try to apprehend you. But I want you to know this one thing. No weapon that's formed against you shall ever prosper. But we know this, that the door that God opens, no man, no person can shut. And the door that God closes, no man can open. And I pray this morning that we have the discernment of when God is opening and shutting doors and that we have the discernment of what he's saying. There was a TV show and there's a, you know, Father Knows Best. God knows. God knows what's best. He knew, he's all-knowing. He knew the decisions we would make before we would make them. He's orchestrating this life for us. We have to walk in the obedience. He's laid out a path that he has given us the Holy Spirit that will guide us to where we're to go and how we're to live and how we're to be and how we're to treat others and to love one another. Because I'm telling you, it's not easy. It's not always easy to love the person that's making fun of you. The person that's causing you problems and trauma and maybe even taking business away from you or distracting you from what it is that you're supposed to do. But God tells us to pray for that person, to bless that person, to walk in his love. And I know it's not always easy, but it's the Holy Spirit that will guide us, and it's God who will give us the grace to be who the people that he wants us to be. And we have to realize this. It's not just like, it's not always this quick thing, but that transformation process sometimes takes time. The children of Israel had to go through the wilderness. It took time to get to the promised land. Sometimes, but here's the thing I know, he's a just God. He'll forgive us as we walk in his love. The last thing I just want to say is God, he's always working things out on our behalf. Now, I remember my father, going to Copper's chemical plant every day, sometimes having to work doubles, sometimes having to work on Saturdays. But my father was always working. God is always working. He's always working things out on your behalf. But we have to trust him, and we have to know that he's the one doing it. I want to close this morning in the book of John, chapter 17. And we're going to start with verse 25. And this is Jesus's, this was the prayer of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. He said, "All righteous Father, although the world has not known you, yet I have known you. And these have known that you sent me. And I have made your name known to them, and will make it known so that the love with which you loved me may be in them and I in them." That's my prayer for us today. That the love that was in God, that the love that was in Jesus, that love would be in us. That we would love our neighbors and our friends and our families enough to share with them the love of Jesus Christ. It's not always a tract. It's not always a Bible verse to them. Sometimes it's just a simple word. There was a young man that, and young lady that they've been walking the streets and, doing what people do out there. And they were in this back alley, and they had talked with Dave. And in fact, the young man, his testimony was that Dave and him were mortal enemies. He said, "But then one day I sat down and I talked with him and shared my story." He goes, "Man, I know that man loves me." Well, now they live near us. And we had Bible study on a Wednesday night. And we just didn't know what to say or how to approach them. And Kate felt led to pray for them on the Bible study. So after the Bible study, we're on the porch and we're just sitting there, and it was getting a little cold out, and I thought about going inside, and I said, "Oh, you know what, let's just stay out just a little longer." And I'm glad we did, because Jason and T walked by. And Kate said to them, she said, "Hey, what's your names?" The girl kind of looked like, "Why are you going to report us?" And the gentleman said, "Oh, no," and he told us their names. She says, "Oh, I just want to know because we're praying for you. We're believing God for you." And he began to tell us his story. And then he said, and we told him, I said, "Well, we go to this church," and we explained where it was. And he said, "Hey, does a guy with a goatee go there?" And he was talking about Dave. And I said, "Yes." He goes, "Man, God's trying to tell me something." I said, "He sure is." And part of his testimony was that he got hooked on drugs by an injury he had in the military. And so he got addicted to these painkillers, and now he's out there on the street. Now, we could turn up our nose and say, "Well, why doesn't he just quit?" and all these things. But they began to walk away, and the Lord just said, "I'm sorry if I start to break down," because it just, when God shows up, He began to walk away. I said, hey, wait a minute. I said, I just want to tell you one thing. Thank you for serving. And if you would have saw the look on it, it wasn't, I mean, I could tell you appreciate the prayer. I could tell you appreciated all the things that people have told him. But when I told him that, he knows that God loves him. Here yet, and I believe that I want you to write their names down, Jason and T. We're going to pray. I want us to pray like you never, I don't care. I want you to pray like that they are your own children, because I believe that God wants to save them. I believe that they have a testimony that God wants to share with the world, and that he could take them out of that mess. I've seen it happen before. We have examples in our own church. But it's going to take being that father to the fatherless. Because we are, as the church, we are the hands and feet of Jesus. Let's bow our heads. Heavenly Father, I just pray this morning, Lord God. It's just been on my heart heavy, Lord God, to pray for family reconciliation, Lord God. There are families that have been torn apart, Lord God. I pray that sons and daughters would come back to the fathers, and that fathers would have their arms open to receive their children. Lord God, I pray that during this time, I know that there are many that are grieving and miss their loved ones. But Lord God, you said that you build a home for those that are lonely. I pray, Lord God, that in your habitation, Lord God, that you would bless those, bless the widow, bless those that are by themselves, bless those that miss their father this morning. But Lord, I pray that you would come in like a mighty rushing wind and bring your peace and your joy in their life. And no one person can be all the things all the time to everybody. So you pull on each one of us. Some of us in here, Lord God, are hands, and some of us are feet, some of us are the eyes, the ears. We all have a role to play in your kingdom. I pray that you give us the fortitude and the strength to do what it is you've called us to do. In the wonderful name of Jesus, I pray, Lord God, that your love and your peace would be in us, and that we would show that love in this world today. And that we would let our light shine in darkness, and that it would draw people to you, to the saving knowledge of who you are, Jesus Christ. I pray that everybody have a productive week this week. I pray that you, whatever your plans are this afternoon, that you would be blessed in them. Protect everybody here. Protect all those that are online watching. Be with them. And bless them in the wonderful name of Jesus. We give you glory. And all of God's people said, amen. Well, the offering plates are at the back of the church. And if you'd like to put your tithe in or give this morning, do so as you walk out. We're just changing things because of, you know, the virus that is, you know, that is prevalent out there. We have to practice wisdom. Definitely pray for everybody's protection, but we also have to exercise wisdom. And when the time's right, we'll go back to the things as normal, or what we are used to. But right now, this is how we'll do it. And if you're watching online, you can send your check to the P.O. Box 987, and that's in Steubenville, Ohio, 43952, and we'll get your tithe that way if you would like. And you spell million, M-I-L-L-I-O-N, because we want to reach a million souls for Jesus, and we're doing that right now. I believe when it's said and done, man, we're going to go in heaven, and people are going to come up to you, and they're going to say, man, you don't know, when you gave that dollar, when you gave that check, when you gave that money, that allowed the gospel to be preached and to reach me, And I'm here today because of your generosity and your giving. And guess what? You're going to be blessed that day, but man, God's also going to bless you and take care of your household. So Lord, I thank you for these. I love you guys. I would love to be at the back of the church hugging your necks and shaking your hands. I can't do that right now as I continue to recover from my own surgeries and things as well. But love you guys. Have a happy Father's Day to all the fathers, and enjoy your Sunday. God bless.